Aloha everyone, and thank you for joining the COVID-19 Public Health Action Webinar, Coping with COVID-19 High School Edition. My name is Makamai Namahoi, and I am the Public Health Programs Associate. Before we get started, there are some Zoom housekeeping to go over. Next slide, please. For all questions, please utilize the chat box or question and answer box located at the bottom of your screen. No continuing education credits will be provided during this webinar series, and all webinars will be available on the Hawai'i Public Health Training Hui's YouTube channel. Without further ado, I would like to introduce you to our presenters for today. Mestisa Gass, PsyD, is the Program Director for Mental Health America of Hawai'i. Her education and experience has been focused on diverse populations, including inpatient acute adolescent care, community mental health, and military mental health. She is a co-chair for the American Foundation of Suicide Prevention, Hawai'i chapter, a member of the Mental Health Task Force, the statewide Suicide Prevention Task Force, and an advisory board member for the Waipahu Aloha Clubhouse. Since 2006, she has been working in Hawai'i, being originally from the Appalachian Mountains. She is passionate about bringing education, support, and resources to all communities, especially rural areas like those in which she grew up. Our next speaker is Momi Tolentino. Momi hails from the island of Hawai'i, but currently resides in Ka'ava. She recently graduated from Dartmouth College, where she received a BA in sociology and anthropology and followed the college's pre-health track. She currently works for Papa Ola Lōkahi as a communications and community relations assistant, as well as Next Gen Hawai'i's as a social media coordinator and ambassador. Since moving back home to Hawai'i, she has enjoyed serving her native Hawaiian community through her various community-oriented roles and hopes to continue her work as a medical student in the future. So without further ado, I will turn it over to Mestisa.
Aloha everyone, thank you so much. I'm gonna go ahead and share my screen with you. So a little bit of the stuff that we're going to be talking about today, I do want this to be both educational but also interactive. So if you have any questions, please feel free to drop those into the chat. But what we're going to be talking about a little bit today is just the impact that this last 17 months has had on the adolescents, what you can do to kind of bolster that in terms of self-care, and then some of the resources that are available. So we'll just go ahead and get started with talking about what the past 17 months, specifically COVID and the quarantine, what that's looked like for adolescent mental health. The statistics, they're just not quite in yet, but what the early numbers are showing is that, and this is across all age groups, that there has been an increase in anxiety, depression, and sleep-related issues. So those sleep-related issues would just be quality of sleep, just not getting about, on average, 30 minutes of quality sleep. For those who did contract COVID-19 and healed from it, 6 months after healing, what we're seeing is that people are still having neurological symptoms, and those absolutely match up to what we just mentioned. So that's depression, anxiety, and sleep-related issues. So you can see that people are being impacted for a long amount of time. So let's talk a little bit about adolescence as a time period of development. When we start to look at that in the last, several months and all the things that have impacted it, one of the things that stands out is the idea, the knowledge that we have, that this is a time period where people are really figuring out who they are. They do that by interacting with their peers. And so they see things that their friends are doing and they say, I like that. That's going to be part of who I am and what my value is. Or they see something and they say, I don't like that. And that's okay, but that's not going to be who I am. That's going to be disrupted when you're at home and you're not having as much peer-to-peer interaction. So we're expecting to see a little bit of kind of like a lag time in terms of people, specifically adolescents, developing that really strong sense of self. Why is that crucial? Because that strong sense of self tells you who you are and what you want to do. That's that launching period into going maybe to college, finding your first job. And we know that all of those transitions have absolutely been disrupted and made more challenging. We also know that during that time period, there's some really important sentimental rituals that are part of that transition. When we talk to people who are coming out of high school, because 17 months is a very long time to have disruption, they had an idea of what certain rituals would be. And when I say rituals, I'm talking about, graduation from high school, starting that first job, and those things had to be adapted in very significant ways. And the reason I say that is because we have to honor the fact that grief isn't just about losing someone. It's also about losing something, an ideal, an expectation. And a lot of people who are transitioning in that adolescent phase, they are grieving. They're grieving these disrupted rituals, these disrupted kind of transition periods. So please, like if that is you, be patient with yourself and get that support that you need because it's unique. It's very unique to your age group. If you have someone in your life that you care about who's in that age group, understand that they're trying to figure out what all that means to them and that it's very unique for this time period. So they're going to need some support. And that's what we're here today talking about, is how to have some better mental health literacy around adolescents and what they've just been through and what they're currently going through. There are two other things I think we would be remiss if we didn't mention, and that's reentry anxiety and languishing. Reentry anxiety, you've probably heard that talked about a lot recently. That is this idea that you're going back to old activities or even new activities, but you feel anxious. You feel anxious because you're not sure if you feel safe. It's been a really long time since you did those things. And that's okay. You're going to be getting in the email after this presentation some tips on how to deal with it. But really the tips are take baby steps, go slow, be patient with yourself, adapt if you need to adapt. And in all things, it's nice to have a buddy, right? So if you have a buddy who wants to do the same activities as you, communicate clearly with them where you're at, where your comfort level is, and so that you can do those things together. And languishing, it's just this idea that for a vast majority of us, and specifically adolescents, it's really hard for them to feel motivated to enjoy the things that they're doing. There's just this general kind of like numbness or dullness and boredom. It's that idea when they say, what day is it? And you're like, Blair's day. I don't know what day it is, because that has been a little bit of all of our experience over the past couple of months. So just know if it's hard to get motivated, and then when you go to do that thing because you're motivated and then you don't enjoy it, you can see why that would be a challenge and why it's really nice to have a buddy and doing those things. Before we even moved into that time period, there were pre-existing challenges specific to adolescents. And so this is some information coming out of our youth risk behavioral survey. This is actually 2015 to 2017, available at 2019. Research and data is slow. So you'll be seeing 2020 numbers in a couple of years. But the important part of this is that this is specific to Hawaii. And this is stuff that was pre-existing, what just happened, and is currently existing. So what were we seeing then in these self-reported surveys? About 21.9% of students had been struggling with feeling bullied on school property or electronically, and that was over a 12-month period. 66.7% of students felt sad, empty, hopeless, angry, or anxious. 20.9% of students said that most of the time or always they're getting the help they needed, and that's great, but that means the vast majority of them weren't. And then about 16.7% of students had serious consideration for attempting suicide over a 12-month period, and about 34.7 reported depression in a 12-month period. So you can see why it's so important we talk about mental health literacy and figure out how to best support this really unique group of individuals. We talked about reentry anxiety. We talked about languishing and how there's so many things impacting our adolescence. And I think that it's fair to say that a lot of us are like, well, then how do we know if it's too much? How do we know if this is a normal response to an abnormal situation, or that this is something I should be really cautious about? And I would say what you're looking for is like the significance and the time period. So if it's happening consistently for two or more weeks every day, and it's really significant in what you're seeing, then that's when we start to have those conversations and see if support, especially professional help, might not be needed. What are we looking for? Mood dysregulation, again, anxiety, depression. Anhedonia, you're not getting enjoyment out of doing the things you're trying to do. Express suicidality, having negative impact on work and school, withdrawing and isolating, not doing daily activities like bathing, eating, exercising, and then having those interrupted relationships. Again, you might have pieces of this throughout a time period, but if you're seeing multiple of these every day for more than 2 weeks, absolutely please engage that person and talk to them to see if they need support. With that quick snapshot of what we're looking at, what can we do to help? The first thing I want to talk to you about is self-care. Think about yourself like a bank account. And so this emotional bank account is something that you have to put into, you have to deposit into every single day. I don't need an hour. I just need 5 to 10 minutes of your time to put something in case you need to withdraw in the near future. What are some things that you can do? Stay present. We can't change the past, the future. Very quick to adapt and like move in unexpected ways, as we've seen. So try to stay present in the moment and do what you need to do with whatever is right in front of you. And that could be part of just practicing mindfulness, looking at radical acceptance, which says it just is what it is. You know, like I'll put my energy where I can make change, and I'm not going to put my energy where I can't, because that just has me feeling like I'm spinning my wheels. I'm going to validate how I feel, because I know that feelings are just feelings. They're informative, but my behavior is what determines whether or not that's healthy or not. I'm going to try to stay connected with the people I care about, and I'm going to stay informed, but not overcheck. And I'm going to really look for those heartwarming stories, those helper stories. If I have people in my life who are vulnerable or essential workers, I'm just going to reach out and say, I'm thinking about you, because it makes me feel good too. If there are creatures in your life, like if you have pets or you have friends who have pets, absolutely, they're great for decreasing stress and blood pressure. So if you have access, please utilize as much as is available. And then try to follow us like a schedule. It's really tempting to have pajama time all day. I think we were all really excited about that months and months ago, but we started to realize again, it just blurs. It blurs the days and it blurs the time. And it makes it really difficult to us to feel like we have concrete transitions from work or school to like personal time. If you're someone who has really awesome intentions, but not great outcomes, transparently, I do that sometimes. Just schedule in self-care. Just pop that 5 to 10 minutes in, whether it's in the morning or lunch or right before bedtime, so you make sure that you get it. And then use social media responsibly. I know we spend a lot more time, the adolescents spend a lot more time, and that is their culture, and that's fine. It's just different from generation to generation. And I think here is where I would adapt it a little bit and say, not just use social media responsibly, but use it mindfully and intentionally, and decide on using it as a tool to connect, to make you have fun, and to realize that some of those reels and some of those posts, they're just the best of, and that's what you're seeing. I enjoy the posts where they're like, this is what you see, and this is behind the scenes, because it does remind us that it's really just the best of real. There's a lot of really great online resources. So if you're looking for something, now is a great time to find it online, because a lot of different organizations have adapted. And if you find them, share them, even if you don't need them, because someone else might. And then when you're ready to unplug, absolutely go spend time in nature. The more that we can kind of ground and get back into nature and enjoying the beautiful place in which we live, the more grounded we'll have and the better we'll feel in self-care. And then, of course, create a support plan. So with a support plan, the important part is you have it before you need it. Know who you'll call, who you enjoy talking to. Know who's a good listener to talk to about what's actually happening. Have those numbers of your providers saved in your phone if you need them. Know what those top self-care pieces are so you can have them and access them when you really need them at your fingertips. And also know what gives your life meaning. Like, what are you going to lean into when you're having a challenging day? And here's why I'm going to teach you two specific skills, because while I would love to go over all these stats, what's most helpful for people is to walk away with something they can use. The first thing I'm going to teach you is diaphragmatic breathing. So I'm going to have you put your hand on your diaphragm. If you're unsure where that is, make sure that pinky is just resting right on that belly button. Then put your hand, put your other hand on your upper chest. Now, what we're going to do is we're going to take a deep breath in, and we're going to try to move the hand on our diaphragm more than the hand on your chest. I'm a little sniffly, so I'll be breathing in through my mouth and out through my mouth. But if you're not sniffly, breathe in through your nose, hold it for as long as it's comfortable, and then bring out through your mouth. So taking in that deep breath, moving your diaphragm hand more than the hand on your upper chest, breathe in. Hold it for as long as it's comfortable, and then breathe out. Again, just focusing on that location, moving that lower hand more. Let's breathe in deep. Hold it for a few seconds or as long as it's comfortable. And then slowly breathe that back out. Why is deep breathing, also known as diaphragmatic breathing, so effective? It's free, you can use it anywhere. And when you over-oxygenate the brain by pulling in that deep breath, it actually triggers your nervous system to start to calm down and interpret those signals as calming signals. So let's take in one more deep breath. Holding it in for a few seconds and then slowly breathe back out. Awesome. And I'm going to teach you probably one of the most effective ways to calm the nervous system, to bring your stress down rapidly. And that is the dive response. So on the side of your nose, you have a gland. And when you go swimming, it activates because it gets cold and wet. What does it do? Well, it keeps you from bringing, like taking in an involuntary breath. And it also slows down your heart rate and your blood pressure. So that immediately is going to calm the nervous system. Now, you can't go swimming every time you feel stressed, but you can have a couple of different alternatives to doing that. The first one is putting your face into a bowl of cold water and just submerging that portion of the face to make sure that gland gets cold and wet, holding your breath, and then coming back out of the water and moving into deep breathing. The other one you can use is a cold, wet rag and make sure you're putting it across that part of the face so it activates that gland. And again, holding the breath for 10 seconds, letting it back out, and moving into deep breathing. If you can compare, like combine those two things, you're going to get a huge return for just 5 minutes of time. That's why I highly recommend learning these, practicing these, and sharing them, because they very quickly help calm someone. And you don't have to talk, and you don't have to process, you just relax. We wanted to make sure that you had some crisis resources. Again, if you have your phone, please feel free to drop those in them and save them. You will get this in your email. The numbers that we have is, of course, for Mental Health America of Hawaii. If you're looking for some specific services, we have Hawaii Cares, the Suicide Prevention Lifeline and text line. You'll have the Trevor line, which is fantastic for our LGBTIQ youth, Kukua Life app, DVAC, which is our Domestic Violence Action Center, Poison, our Hawaii Poison Hotline, SATC, the Sexual Abuse Treatment Center. And then we also have a place that you can report if there's any concerns about child abuse, neglect, or trafficking. So you'll get these resources, and whichever ones you find helpful, please feel free to save those into your phone, because we want you to have them if you should need them. And then, of course, if you have any questions that come up, you can go to our website, you can email us at that info, and then call us because we're in office. We do have continued kind of community trainings where we go more into depth if you want to learn more skills. This month, we're going to have a youth mental health first aid, a healing and grief at the end of the month, and then a suicide prevention 101, and you'll find those at that website. So thank you so much.
Great. Thank you, Mestisa, for that wonderful presentation. Then we'll pass it over to Momi.
Aloha, everyone. I'm going to share my screen really quick. Awesome. So aloha to everyone who joined us today. Like Maka said, my name is Momi Tolentino, and I am working for Papa'olo Lōkahi, and also for the Office of Public Health Studies as a social media coordinator for a social media project that started last year called Next Gen Hawai'i. So I'm going to share a little bit about kind of how we got to where we are, and then touch on some intersectionality between social media and mental health. So like we kind of can recall, COVID-19 hit us about more than a year ago, and we kind of had this like emergency order for us to work from home, stay at home, and try to minimize contact with other people as much as possible. And it was pretty crazy. I was actually in my senior spring of my senior year at college, and we honestly didn't really see it coming. We thought it would kind of pass through. And so I found myself having a virtual graduation in June and kind of being shunted into the workforce by August. And so as I kind of started to assimilate very quickly to my work that I was doing at Papa'ola Lōkahi, we actually, with a number of different agencies, created this NHPI 3R, so the Native Hawaiian Pacific Islander Response Resilience, and kind of like coalition of organizations that were working on this response to COVID-19. So we kind of had a number of different committees that were working under the umbrella of a national consortium of agencies. And we recognized just, you know, kind of the blaring stories that were going across the media that Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders were being threatened the most by COVID-19, whether that be the death rate or whether that just be infection rates. But we also saw this kind of silver lining in the fact that now that we were at home, you know, you have these multi-generational households and families that can kind of help to assimilate the whole family to this kind of new normal. And so we really wanted to, with the Next Gen Hawai'i kind of social media project, wanted to leverage this idea that people were living in households where there were young people and, you know, like kupuna and like makua in the household that could kind of work together through social media to kind of come together and learn more about COVID-19. And so a lot of it was just, you know, recognizing that there was a disparity for our Native Hawaiian and Pacific Islander communities, and then kind of addressing those in different ways that leveraged the environments that we were living in. And then we also saw that kind of as we move into this new age of COVID-19, that this app called TikTok, and I'm sure everyone has kind of heard it, especially if you work with adolescents, that TikTok kind of took over. A lot of the things that were going around on TikTok had things to do with COVID-19. So a lot of health workers were using it as leverage to debunk COVID-19 myths. A lot of people were sharing their experiences, whether that be, you know, the fear of COVID-19 or like their family getting it, or how they kind of coped with the different ways that COVID has impacted their family. And we saw this huge rise in health education TikToks, whether that be from, you know, young influencers or doctors or other people in the medical community. TikTok was kind of a way to have everyone in this hub of a social media platform and allow people to exchange information. And I think, you know, if you know anything about TikTok and comparing it to the other social media platforms, a lot of what TikTok does is kind of, you know, you have a certain algorithm set to what your interests are, but at the same time, you can come across so many different people's profiles, and it's a really good way to kind of mix up the information that you're hearing from other people and different experiences and kind of getting to know other people who you may not even have gotten to know if you were, you know, just strictly on Facebook or strictly on Instagram or Twitter. And then we also kind of saw this, I would say, dip in health literacy, because a lot of people didn't know a lot about COVID-19, and a lot of the research was relatively new for everyone, even in the research community, in the regular community, in the medical community. So a lot of it was everyone else, you know, trying to get up to pace. And then this added layer that people in Native Hawaiian and Pacific Islander communities, a lot of them, especially in the Pacific Islander communities, don't speak English, and English was the primary language that a lot of these health literacy components were written in. And so kind of another pushing factor on why we wanted to start Next Gen Hawai'i was to kind of help to decrease those barriers to COVID-19 related materials and apply them in a way that was applicable to certain communities and also in their own language. And then as well as kind of leveraging that intergenerational and multi-generational families and households where, you know, one person might speak English, so they would be able to kind of translate a lot of the things to the rest of their family who may not have English as their first language. And so kind of from all of these things that we were looking at in the environment of Native Hawaiian and Pacific Islander communities, like I said, there was this creation of the Native Hawaiian and Pacific Islander Hawai'i COVID 3R team. Sorry, huge mouthful. Usually we just call it the NHPI 3R team. And it was in response to all of the things that were happening within Native Hawaiian and Pacific Islander communities because they were so unique. And we've also seen them happen a lot in a lot of other pandemics that have, you know, made their ways to the islands. And so it was kind of a way for us to purposefully and intricately address the issues that were happening in these specific communities. And so we have probably now over 60 plus Hawai'i based NHNPI partners at the table. There's a number of sub teams. So we wanted to sit under this big umbrella of NHPI, but also recognize that, you know, like data disaggregation, you can't always group all Native Hawaiians and Pacific Islanders into one category. And so there were other alternate committees that focused on specific Native Hawaiian trends and data and issues, and then specific Pacific Islander ones. And a lot of the good work that was being done was done in these working committees. So I'll give a little bit more of a background after, but we have these different working committees. So those that focus on like testing and vaccinations, social support and recovery, data and research, communications and policy. And there also were a number of national partners as well. So this is a big kind of mouthful. I won't go into detail on everything, but a lot of what the data and research committee did was kind of, you know, what is the culturally appropriate response for collecting data and for conducting this research that would actually meet the needs of these NHPI communities? And also just, you know, giving people the tools to understand what the data meant and how they were being calculated. For the testing, contact tracing, isolation, and vaccination committee, it was more so just amplifying the needs in the community. So where are these testing sites? Where can we, or how can we continue to advocate for effective contact tracing? And now as the vaccine kind of is more of a topic, how can we get people to learn more about these vaccination sites and kind of get them in the door? I work under the umbrella of communications a lot. So a lot of the work that we do has to do with just putting out information that is culturally relevant, that is in language, and also just things that are appropriate within the NHPI communities that doesn't, you know, offer up offensive or discriminatory language or imagery. The policy committee worked really hard during the legislative session to kind of help to push for policies that would help these specific communities of people. And then social support and recovery was, you know, put into place to kind of address things like COVID fatigue, or how can we continue to support the needs of the NHPI communities during the pandemic and also after. And so kind of from the you know, the inner workings of a lot of the agencies that were working together through this NHPI 3R kind of coalition, this idea of Next Gen Hawai'i was born. And a lot of it was just to kind of reach those communities and those like, you know, pockets of people who were, you know, utilizing young people as a way. And like through social media, we know that that's a way that a lot of young people stay connected. And now that we're moving into this age of COVID-19, how can we continue to leverage this idea of being together and coming together as a community through means of social media platforms? And so we kind of created this messaging plan. A lot of it was to kind of stick to Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook, and also TikTok. We were actually called like the TikTok challenge initially when we first started, but we wanted to just get the correct information out there to youth. And I think that we've learned that youth with the right information is very powerful, and it can really empower them to feel like they can make decisions, whether that be like, oh, I should get tested. You know, like we went to this family party and like, I'm not really sure if I may or may not have been exposed. You know, like I was wearing my mask, but you know, just kind of giving people or giving the youth the tools that they needed to be well-informed and to be advocates for themselves and for their families. So we kind of had this messaging plan. A lot of it had to do like, where would you find resources? How can you find resources that are in your specific language? And how can you kind of, you know, push these resources out to your larger community? And so I took over social media coordinator, I think probably around Thanksgiving, Christmas time, and we, you know, just kind of went for it. We went through a number of different series. So we talked about COVID classics, you know, like washing your hands, wearing your mask, carrying hand sanitizer around you. And also, you know, how do you access telehealth? How do you tell your grandma, like, you need to log on to your telehealth, but she has no idea how to kind of work the laptop or those kinds of things. So being able to be an aid to kupuna and to makua who are in your household that may not have those tools to access social media. And then we, you know, we talked a lot about vaccinations and mostly just like myth busting. I think a lot of what our aim was not to push people to make a decision or to not make a decision, but to kind of inform them that people their age are doing things and like doing things that they feel necessary to keep their communities safe. This next slide I'm going to show you, it might be a little loud, so you might want to turn down your volume, but these are kind of the different TikToks that we made with our ambassadors. So I believe I have four to show you. She was our Chamorro speaking ambassador. She was there with our first and second phase of our Next Gen Hawai'i, and she kind of was talking in her own specific language about the COVID-19 classics. So, you know, washing your hands and staying 6 feet apart. And then our next is... The one that could break my heart. Oh no, I was doing better alone. She's talking a little bit about telehealth and kind of, you know, the benefits of doing that as opposed to going in to the office for a checkup. And so that was really popular. And I think telehealth really took off in the time of COVID-19. And she speaks English. I love you, baby. So this is one that I actually made. On top of being a coordinator, I also do Native Hawaiian. I'm the Native Hawaiian ambassador. And so this one was our What's in Your Bag series. So kind of, you know, preparing to go out into public, what are the things that you keep in your bag? And so that's kind of what I was sharing. And then our last one is very applicable to what we're talking about today, so about mental health, and it's by Nikki. Yeah, you got me begging, begging, baby, please don't go. If I wake up tomorrow, will you still be here? I don't know. If you feel the way I do, if you leave, I'm gonna find you, baby. Done by Nikki. And what I loved about this project is that it definitely started off as, you know, mostly focusing on Native Hawaiian and Pacific Islander communities. But as we started to expand, we recognized that this was something that could extend past those communities and just into Hawaii in general. And we got a lot of different interests from, this is Nikki, she speaks Tagalog. And also we have another ambassador named Ellery, and she speaks Ilocano. And so you're able to make those connections with the Filipino community as well. And so just kind of tying all of this together and kind of our social media project and also how that relates to mental health. I think that kind of, you know, the pros of social media is that people use it to de-stress and decompress after a long day. Sometimes when you're working a lot and sometimes you just want to watch something funny on social media, that's kind of a way that people have been using it. It allows us to stay in touch with family from the comfort of our own home. So I think like a lot of people, I've recognized that I really enjoy being able to FaceTime people and FaceTime my mom and my dad at the drop of a hat and not have to, you know, well, they live on Big Island, but, you know, some people don't want to drive and go out and see people. Another thing is that We're able to learn more about people from other places in the world at the touch of a button, and that there's a niche for everyone and everything. And so those two are specific to TikTok because the algorithm allows you to be connected to people that are kind of like near and far. And so I think that TikTok has definitely been an awesome platform. Sometimes you don't always get the right information, but a lot of times people are, you know, make you feel like you belong. You learn that other people somewhere in a remote part of the world might be experiencing the same thing as you, and being able to find those similarities is empowering. And then, you know, the cons of social media, I think these things are well researched, but sometimes social media can only show you what's happening that people show you. And it's not really showing you what's happening behind the scenes. And sometimes it can create like unrealistic expectations and standards. And so being careful of how social media can oftentimes, you know, only show the good and not show the bad. But I think that during COVID, a lot of people have become more real and become more raw on social media, which has been super awesome to witness. Establishing relationships on social media can often, you know, absolve us of the responsibility of making deeper connections in person. And I think a lot of times it's just easier to kind of have these relationships at the drop of a hat where you can call someone. And sometimes, you know, the social anxiety surrounding kind of meeting up with someone can be overwhelming. And then lastly, we tend to think that taking time for ourselves is unnatural. I think as we've moved through this time of COVID, we've recognized that this is going to last a lot longer than we thought. And we have to find kind of ways to integrate the life that we had before COVID to the life that we have now during COVID, and, you know, make adjustments as we see necessary at, you know, having to do with work and school and those kinds of things. But I did want to say that one thing is that prioritizing mental health manifests differently for everyone. And that can be using social media, that can be not using social media and kind of jumping off of it for a little second and taking a little hiatus. But I definitely think that social media, the one thing it has done is brought us a lot closer during COVID. And so I just wanted to say a quick mahalo to Papa Ola Lōkahi and the Office of Public Health Studies, who I work under, to Team Centel. She is our kind of like project manager. And then also to the NHPI through our COVID-19 team and the Hawai'i State Department of Health. So that's all I have for you folks today, and looking forward to any questions that you folks have.
Great, Momi. Thank you for that presentation. I thought that that was really great, that message where prioritizing mental health manifests differently for people really resonates, I think, not just with us adults on the call, but also the youth who kind of had their life abrupted with COVID. So we have a couple of questions, but feel free to drop any in the chat and the question as we go through this portion. So the first question I want to ask is to Momi: how can I or the people that we serve become a mental health advocate on social media?
Great question. I think a lot of what we've tried to do at NextGen is to, one, connect with the youth. I think the youth, you know, obviously are the ones who are struggling with it the most because their lives were very much uprooted towards the end. And you know how important high school graduation is for kids in Hawaii. And I think being a mental health advocate can look and feel so many different things. But I think for us at NextGen, we really want to kind of normalize, like, you know, it's okay to self-care. It's okay to kind of talk about the issues. And we've kind of done that through not only making infographics, but more, you know, seeing people's familiar faces and creating videos that kind of break down that barrier between the screen. And being really real and raw about our experiences, I think a lot of social media makes it seem like I said, everything is kind of like fine and dandy, but being an advocate and having those hard conversations about mental health in different ways. So, you know, maybe one set of messaging is the things that you can do to prioritize your mental health, but also another set of messaging could be like, what are the things that we actually really struggle with? Like, you know, for me, it's, yeah, I would love to stay in my pajamas all day and I would love to kind of just like lounge around, but there has to be kind of the hard conversation is there has to be kind of a break between that and kind of, okay, now it's time to work and now it's time to do those things. And so I think a lot of what social media has the power to do is to unveil all of those real and raw experiences while also kind of also offering up solutions. I think the offering up of solutions or the offering up of how you coped with X, Y, and Z can help to break down that barrier and can also help it to feel more real and like a tangible goal to kind of reach.
Awesome. Mestisa, can I ask you the same? What do you think? How can we become a mental health advocate on social media?
I do think it's about modeling and decreasing stigma. You know, we have so many AAPI cultures that come together to kind of, you know, make our experience so beautiful here. But we also know that part of that is that there is a very real stigma that is experienced on different levels for different reasons and different communities. And just being able to like share those posts that are out there, I think they did such a beautiful job. I mean, I love those. Those are so fantastic. And to be able to see those in like the language spoken and have people access it who might not have been able to, just even sharing those and being able to see like there are people modeling the behavior, people sharing that information, and that it is within like my experience in my language is so crucial. And I think that's an easy thing to do on social media, is to find those things and share them.
Thank you. This next question might be to Mestisa, but Momi, if you want to chime in too, feel free. How can you or how can we find support or help when the students that we work with don't have parents and family members who don't take mental health seriously?
That's a fantastic question. And I think that when we really specifically talk about high schoolers, there has been some really great legislation that's just come out for that exact reason. And so just to know that there are a lot of different, especially at our community mental health centers, there are opportunities for children who are 14 and older to opt to get mental health care without the permission of their parents. And the providers who will do that with them will sit down, sign them up, and contact the insurance company so that it doesn't cross back over into billing home, because not every home is a safe place and not every, you know, family is open to mental health or even like if needed, you know, even open to talking about it at all. So we want to make sure they have access to the care. So that is one option, but also just having them attend things like this, go to a community training, because sometimes it's about that seed that you plant, because we do want people just to have better mental health literacy. On the far end of it, teenagers can still get access to care, but on kind of the closer end to it, just have them do like, you know, peer-to-peer groups or psychoeducational trainings, just to start to learn a little bit more and to see that the, you know, we can decrease the stigma and that it can be more, you know, helpful and available to all types of communities. But it doesn't have to be that teenagers who need it don't get access anymore. That has changed very, very recently.
Awesome. Thank you. Momi, if you feel like you want to chime in, had you seen those with the younger generation that you folks have been working with, any of those barriers with the students?
I think, well, mostly coming from my own experience, I think, you know, like my younger brother is a junior about to be senior in high school, and kind of looking at my own family dynamic, I think that mental health is not something that is, you know, like my mom is a very tough mom and she's always like, no, like you can figure it out, or, you know, like not like in a bad way, but she's very like, hey, you just have to like man up and be tough about it. And I think that's very true in a lot of specifically like Native Hawaiian or just like, you know, families in Hawaii, it's not something that you really talk about. And so I have found comfort in kind of like when I scroll through TikTok and I see like, wow, like someone in like some remote part of the world also experienced the same kind of childhood experiences that I have. And like, you know, maybe they're a little bit more vulnerable to talking about it. And obviously that would be like kind of hard for you to just kind of come across a video that relates specific to your experience. But I found that, you know, in a lot of ways, being able to know that someone else that maybe I don't even know could be going through the same thing has a certain level of comfort to it. So not that I'm advocating for people to mindlessly go on TikTok and start scrolling, but I think that there is power in being empowered by other people's experiences.
I agree. I also mindlessly scroll on TikTok sometimes, but you're right. It is therapy to just find that video that's relatable, and you know that you feel like that somebody else in the world is kind of going through what you're going through. Mestisa, this is a question for you, and it's kind of like two part. What can and should professional help include, and is professional help expensive?
So professional help would be one of those things where, like, we'd be talking about maybe seeing someone, like whether it's a licensed clinical social worker, a psychiatrist, a psychologist. There's like a vast array. But I also want to point out, like, sometimes when we talk about help, it doesn't necessarily have to be on that level. You can find people within your community, within your faith system, elders in the community, other mentors who could be a really great stepping stone if someone's a little bit uncomfortable going into that next step for professional help. But if it's someone who is experiencing some of those warning signs, you know, just reaching out and looking. And the first step is just to figure out like what your insurance coverage is. You can call them. They will kind of go through that list with you. You can go to the Hawaii Psychological Association, Psychology Today, and there'll be lists of providers and what insurance they take. So it just makes it much, much easier. And the adolescents can actually see faces and descriptions, because that also helps them say like, no, they don't look cool. I don't want to talk to them. Or like, yeah, I kind of like what they're saying. I'll go there. So you have a little bit more buy-in. And so that would be a really good way to kind of start to open those doors to that professional help. It can be expensive depending upon what your insurance coverage is. And just know that if you don't have that, that there are places that you can go that has sliding fee to no fee. And if that's something that you're looking for, please feel free to call us. We can help give you those numbers to call to see what they're open. I will just kind of give you the heads up that it is a wait a little bit if it's a non-crisis situation. If it's a crisis situation, you can always call that Hawaii Cares number and they will help evaluate that for you and also connect you to services.
Thank you for that. One question that we have, what are examples of self-care that you both do? If you are would love to share, Mestisa, I'll have you up first.
Yeah, I actually go, like, I am a huge advocate for self-care, but it's also because I'm also in a unique position. You heard me talk a little bit about healing and grief, and this is just me being transparent. I'm going through my own healing from grief process. So I'm very passionate about making sure every weekend I get into that ocean to do that dive response, and I go hiking to kind of burn off that extra energy. And that's the weekend, right? So what do I do from the day to day? I garden, I spend time with my pets, and I read. I think it was Nicole. I was like, I'm feeling that video because she was watching like K-dramas and reading and was taking a nap. I'm like, oh, that's my jam right there. I can do all those things every day. But it is, it's unique to every individual person. I also normally start like trainings to say like, what's given you hope over the last 17 months? Because people have just the most amazing things that they've been doing that feels good to them. And sometimes I just like, yep, yeah, I think I'll do that too then, because I love seeing what works for other people and trying it myself. So I think that's a fantastic question that you asked.
You, Momi, well, how about you? Do you watch K-dramas as well? Or do you detox and de-stress in other ways?
I don't watch Korean dramas, but I had so many friends in college that did that I was like, maybe I should start watching it. Like, maybe that's where it's at. But I would say I'm a huge, like, nature person. Like, I love just, like, you know, going on hikes or going to the beach and kind of just having that, like, downtime. I also, like, am really big on de-stressing with music. So I love to listen to music. I used to, you know, enjoy kind of watching like Netflix, but I find that I don't have like a show that I can kind of binge on anymore. So it's not as like fun. So yeah, I would definitely say just kind of like getting out into nature and picking flowers and listening to music is something that I'm a super huge advocate. I love doing face masks, although I do like the Aztec one. So like, it's a lot to like make the thing to put on my face and then take it off. And sometimes I'm like, this is just too much work. Like, it should be much easier. But yeah.
Gathering from the two of you, we're getting outside, getting in nature, we're taking care of our skin. Yeah, I'm all for it. I'm very self-care. What's one question, you know, if you both can answer, and especially in the experiences that you two had, if we have students who who are expressing negative, like self-harm and suicidal thoughts, and, you know, how, as we, as advocates for mental health, support youth with those thoughts. How, you know, are there resources, are there tips and techniques, certain messaging that we should be communicating to those who are having those thoughts? Any, you know, if you have anything to share, please, either one. Mestisa, if you would like to get off.
Yeah, sure. So if you have some concerns about students, you know, the first thing we always say is like, be a good listener, so that when you start to talk to them, they know that they can kind of open up if there are any challenges. Like if you're really concerned that this is someone who could be having like suicidal thinking, just ask the question. Just go ahead and immediately ask the question, because it doesn't put it into their thought. It actually shows that you're someone who's comfortable talking about it. Even if you're not comfortable, that's okay. We always use that metaphor, be a duck on water, where like you look very calm on the top and the surface, and underneath it's just, you know, chaos and anxious. Like, what are they going to say? And that's okay. You just want to model, like, you know, I am a safe person to talk to. And then, you know, of course, follow your procedures for your school as to what you would do next. If it is, you know, someone that's reporting that they're unsafe, making sure that you don't leave them alone, you connect them with like the appropriate help. I'm assuming that would be like school counselors, who would then make the rest of the connectors to make sure they have that professional help and support. We know that it can be a very impulsive kind of thought process, and not everyone has a plan and not everyone's going to act on it, but really making sure that we know whether or not that is part of their experience, and that they have that support around them, and that they know, like, it doesn't have to be that you're calling someone because maybe they're a little bit uncomfortable, that they do have that text line. If it's an LGBTIQ youth, that there is the Trevor hotline that's always available, that they have people who are specially trained to be able to speak to that competency. So just to know that there are those resources available, but to start just the basics, like be a good listener, ask the question, and then absolutely connect them immediately to resources if they need to be safe.
Thank you. I totally agree. One last question. The pandemic has been a transition, has taken a lot mentally to adjust to all the changing conditions. Do you have any recommendations for continuing to cope with transitions? Either one, Mestisa, I think it's kind of to the two of you, if you folks have any recommendations.
Yeah, I would say that, you know, it is fascinating that this is a time in history where the people that you would be talking to, let's say, for example, professionally, that professional help, they're in the same boat as you. And so they're also feeling overwhelmed and tired. And sometimes your support system itself is feeling tired and overwhelmed. And so you're not always sure like who to talk to or what to do. But I would say like, do the self-care, take it slow. If you go try something and it just felt really anxiety inducing, that's okay. Just kind of pull it back a little bit. And then start a little bit slower, adapt, be patient. Again, find that buddy that you can go do things with. Like every week that I'm doing something, it's with somebody, so that I know my support system is healing at the same time that I'm also healing, because we all need to go in the ocean. We all need to go out and connect with nature. And it's really hard if you're the person who's like typically the go-getter. I still have energy. Like, let's go do this thing. And then you have a lot of people in your support system who are just like, how about we just like sit on the couch? So you just want to be patient, take your time, but also maybe like mix it up a little bit so that you do have time with people who are, you know, just not there yet, so that you can like play those board games at home. I love that idea. We play all kinds of board games over the weekend as well. And we just have low energy activities and high energy activities, and we adapt according to like what people need in the moment. So those would be my highest recommendations. Have grace with yourself and patience. We're all slowly getting back to the kind of new pace in life.
Yeah, no, agreed. Sorry, we actually do have one more question, and this one is for Momi. Is there a way for folks to get involved with Next Gen Hawai'i? And how would we do that?
So right now we're kind of in a little, we started in October, I could be wrong, around October, and we've kind of, I think we're right now on our third phase of the project. I think if you want to get involved, you can definitely email me or Tatine Santel, who is our kind of project manager. Right now, a lot of our focus is on vaccination, like social norming and kind of just getting that information and myth busting and those kinds of things. But we definitely are working on plans and would love to work with other organizations on how to continue this project. I think that's definitely there's a lot of kind of layers to like how that would kind of pan out, but I definitely think that we are super open just to work with other organizations. And I think that we've connected with a lot of them through social media to say like, hey, can you like bump our project, like we'll share yours and kind of those kinds of things. So definitely shoot us an email. We'd love to be involved in any way possible and kind of helping to push out this information to our youth.
Awesome. And we'll make sure to the participants on the call, we'll make sure to share all those resources and that contact information in our Mahalo email with both Momi and Mestisa's resources. So given we have a few minutes remaining, we do want to ask you both if you folks have any, just one last thought, any final thoughts to give to our participants on the call. Mestisa, if you wanted to go first, just 1 or 2 minutes of your final thoughts.
I just want to say a big mahalo for everyone coming today. And I think we talk about all the challenges we've had, but as a community, I think we've done just an amazing job in facing it. And so community resiliency just boils down to each individual person becoming more and more resilient and then sharing that skill with someone else. And so for all of you coming today, like, I just want to say mahalo because you're supporting our community, you're supporting our adolescents in this really challenging kind of crossover transition time, which they need so much, as we all do. And I hope that this weekend you get a few minutes out in nature to kind of get some of that energy back and do some self-care.
And I guess just from my perspective, one tip that I've really learned is that sometimes you don't need to make plans to kind of do elaborate things. A lot of times just, you know, asking a friend to come on something you would normally do, like I'm going to Target or I'm going to the grocery store, like, do you want to come? And those kinds of things. I found that those outings are oftentimes more meaningful. And from there, you can kind of gauge, you know, where your friend is at and like if you want to do something else or like, you know, it's kind of a headway to lead to other plans that might be able to help them open up to you in different ways. And yeah, kind of making, I think a lot of it is there's so much pressure to kind of be normal and kind of go back to normal, but to kind of take that pressure away and to make others feel very safe just being around you. I think that kind of opens the door for other people to kind of confide in you or to share information that maybe they wouldn't have shared with someone else or with you in general. So I'd say definitely continue building those relationships and trying to stay sane. I think a lot of what it is like we're all really tired, but we're all just trying to do the right thing and we're all just trying to prioritize ourselves and our families and those kinds of things. But thank you so much to HIPHI for having me on this webinar. And it was so awesome to kind of hear from you too, Mestisa, on kind of the work that you get to do with youth and mental health.
So again, I just want to thank both Mestisa and Momi for being our guests for today's webinar. Thank you all for on Zoom for joining us. And I want to thank the HIPHI staff behind the scenes helping to coordinate this webinar. Please save the date for August 3rd as our next webinar. And the topic and details will be coming out shortly. Be safe and be well. And we hope to see you all on our next webinar. Aloha.